Hey, check it out. They got black blades. All right. This little town of Pipestone I'm driving through right now, Pipestone, Minnesota, they do a lot of work with these turbines. In fact, they used to make these blades here. And I think what they've done is painted them. But I wanted to get it, I don't know if I can go up too close to it or else I'll get in trouble with the law. You know, terrorist with a camera. But you can see, they're all over. There's like 300 and something of them located up in this area. Wow, huh? Even the towers are painting gray, I see. There's a big one. They got like a noise to it though, you can hear it. But yeah, that, I'll tell you, that's just awesome. Black blades. And it's gotta be so they keep the snow and ice off them. The buildup. Wow, I can hear that baby. I wish I could get up closer. But yeah, that head on that, look at how massive that is. Looks like some of their decals falling off on it. But yeah, I thought I'd show you that. Look at the base of that. All the way down. Oops, sorry. All the way down, all the way up. Isn't that slick? I wish I had one of those in my backyard. I'd power my whole damn city. Yeah, well, here we go. I'm a couple hours yet from home, coming back from Denver. Man, that was a beautiful experience out there. I'm gonna help out Tim and his neighbors and everything get going on their off-grid situation. And Steve also, Jaeger, he's gonna help out Silent Death. Orland's gonna help out. We're all gonna pitch in to help out these people in Denver that are wanting to be off-grid. And I'm all for it, man. I want that off-grid experience because I can't have it. I mean, in my neighborhood, I couldn't own anything real big. I mean, I can own one of my axle fluxes, about 8.4, 8.5 diameter blade set, but otherwise, no. You know, off-grid, man, it's awesome. I wish the hell I could do it. Maybe one day. Alright, well, this is Billy, and I'm gonna head on home. If I see anything else interesting, I'll show it. Have a good one.
Minnesota blows. Actually, Minnesota is a beautiful place that is home to a lot of wonderful people. But state politicians are blowing billions of dollars on wind power and getting next to nothing in return except higher electricity costs for ratepayers while lining the pockets of some well-connected special interest groups. The whole fiasco is discussed in detail in a new report by the Center of the American Experiment. Several years back, state leaders decided that it would be politically beneficial to them if the land of 10,000 lakes cut greenhouse gas emissions. The plan for achieving this goal was to erect thousands of industrial wind turbines. When this love affair with wind energy began, the people of Minnesota were paying some of the lowest electricity rates in the nation, almost 20% less than the national average. But as more turbines began spinning, that price advantage started shrinking. By early 2017, for the first time, Minnesota ratepayers were paying more than the national average. For this privilege, Minnesota spent an estimated $10 billion on wind turbines and billions more on upgraded transmission lines. If Minnesota had simply kept its historic electricity price advantage, ratepayers would have saved an estimated $4.4 billion over the last 7 years, or roughly $1,500 for a family of four. Let's assume some people in Minnesota are okay with spending billions of dollars on wind power so they can feel good about substantially lowering greenhouse gas emissions. Except, that's not what's happening. From 2005 to 2014, Minnesota's carbon emissions dropped by 6.6%. However, in this same time period, America's emissions dropped by 9.3%, about 40% more than Minnesota's. In fact, the state's CO2 emissions from the electric power sector in 2014 were the same as in 1990, long before the state began investing enormous amounts of money into budget-busting turbines. There are quite a few reasons why Minnesota's big wind spend is failing so catastrophically. For example, most citizens are unaware that the electric grid must match supply and demand every second of the day. This means that wind energy's inescapable, chronic intermittency is a major problem. When the wind slows down or stops, another energy source, typically coal or natural gas, has to produce more electricity so the lights don't go out. Having extra power capacity from natural gas and coal on standby is an expensive duplication of infrastructure. And wind has another big problem. It tends to produce the most output when it's needed least, and the opposite is also true. In Minnesota, the peak of electricity demand comes in August, the month when the wind doesn't blow very much. Then there's the problem of location. The electricity is needed for the Twin Cities in the southeast part of the state, but the wind blows hardest in the western and northern regions of Minnesota, so connecting the wind turbines to the electricity users has resulted in billions of dollars spent on new and upgraded transmission lines. I know what you're thinking. Why are Minnesota's politicians doing this to their citizens? Well, follow the money. Big wind companies make huge profits taking advantage of generous federal subsidies and tax credits. Big wind's lobbyists spend a lot of time making sales pitches to state legislators. And exactly how many lobbyists are representing the interests of Minnesota ratepayers? That's right, not a one. Hey, Minnesotans, when will you start demanding that energy policies be based on science and not be written by special interest lobbyists? Power on, America.